Naranjana. Yashodha Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Jamuna Tiravanachari. Jamuna Tiravanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivaradhari. Yashodha Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Yashodha Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Jamuna Tiravanachari. Jamuna Tiravanachari. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Radha Madhava Radha Madhava Radhe. Jaya Radha Gopinatha Radha Gopinatha Radhe. Jaya Gauranitai Gauranitai Gauranitai, Jaya Gauranitai. Jaya Girdhari Gopal, Jaya Girdhari Gopal, Girdhari Gopal, Jaya Girdhari Gopal. Jaya Vamana Dev, Jaya Vamana Dev, Vamana Dev, Jaya Vamana Dev. Jaya Ji Goswami Prabhupada Jaya Ji Goswami Prabhupada Jaya Ji Goswami Prabhupada Jaya Ji Goswami Prabhupada Jaya Prabhupada 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 Jaya Prabhupada Jaya Vishnubhad, Amham, Saprivajakachari, Ashtotra, Shadashri, Srimad, His Divine Grace, Abhacharna, Aravinda, Bhakti, Vedanta, Swami, Prabhupada, Ki, Jaya. Anantakoti, Vaishnavrinda, Ki, Jaya. All grace assembled devotees, all grace to Sri Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 8, Chapter 23. Basically, reading from chapter called The Demigods Regain the Heavenly Planets. Mantratas tantratas chidram desha kalharha vastutaha sarvam karoti nishchidram anu sankirtanam tava This is Canto 8, Chapter 23, Text Number 16. I am reading just the translation and purport. There may be discrepancies in pronouncing the mantras and observing the regulative principles. And moreover, there may be discrepancies in regard to time, place, person and paraphernalia. But when your Lord's holy name is chanted, everything becomes faultless. Purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has recommended Harer Nama Harer Namaiva Kevalam Kalo Nastyeva 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 Katiranyatha. In this age of quarrel and hypocrisy, the only means of deliverance is chanting the holy name of the Lord. There is no other way. Brihat Naridya Puran, 38th chapter, verse number 126. In this age of Kali, it is extremely difficult to perform Vedic ritualistic ceremonies or sacrifices perfectly. Hardly anyone can chant the Vedic mantras with perfect pronunciation or accumulate the paraphernalia for Vedic performances. Therefore, the sacrifice recommended in this age is Sankirtan, constant chanting of the holy name of the Lord. Yagyaihi Sankirtana Prayair Yajantihi Sumedasaha. Instead of wasting time performing Vedic sacrifices, those who are intelligent, those who possess good brain substance should take to the chanting of the Lord's holy name and thus perform sacrifice perfectly. I have seen that many religious leaders are addicted to performing yagyas and spending hundreds and thousands of rupees for imperfect social performances. This is a lesson for those who unnecessarily execute such imperfect sacrifices. We should take the advice of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Yagyai Sankirtana Prayer Yajantihi Sumedasaha. Although Shukracharya was a strict Brahmana, addicted to ritualistic activities, he also admitted, Nishchidram Anusankirtanam Tava. My Lord, constant chanting of the holy name of your Lordship makes everything perfect. In Kali Yuga, the Vedic ritualistic ceremonies cannot be performed as perfectly before. Therefore, Sri Rajiva Goswami has recommended that although one should take care to follow all the principles in every kind of spiritual activity, especially in the worship of the deity, there is still a chance of discrepancies, and one should compensate for this by chanting the holy name of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In our Krishna Consciousness movement, we therefore give special stress to the chanting of the Hare Krishna mantra in all activities. Om Agyanti Mirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadhati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Rutapadakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhamvitamsha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Prishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vanchakalpatarubhyascha Kripasindubhyayavacha Patitanam Pavanibhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Mantratas-tantratas-chidram desha-kalhara-vastutaha sarvam karoti nishchidram anusankirtanam tava. There may be discrepancies in pronouncing the mantras and observing the regulative principles. And moreover, there may be discrepancies in regard to time, place, person and paraphernalia. But when your Lordship's holy name is chanted, everything becomes faultless. Hare Krishna, we just heard the translation and purport to this very interesting verse, the content of the verse. But equally important is to understand who spoke this. Shri, this utterance is from Shukracharya. Who is Shukracharya? Shukracharya is the advisor, the guru, the mentor of Bali Maharaj. And who is Bali Maharaj? The devotee of Lord Vamandev, who surrendered himself completely. And who is Lord Vamandev? The Divine Personality of Godhead, whose appearance we are celebrating today. So this is a little bit of flashback or trace back. Now Shukracharya is speaking this verse in a very interesting context. So we'll have to go a little behind to understand how did all this begin. Why is Shukracharya speaking all this? The story begins almost 8 or 9 chapters before this, in the 8th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, with an inquiry of Maharaj Parikshit. Maharaj Parikshit is inquiring from the Supreme Lord. Balhe padatrayam bhume kasmadhari rayachat bhuteshwarha kripana ballava dhartho pi mabandhatam etat veditu vichhamah omahat kautuhalam hinah yeshwarasya purnasya bandhanam chapyarangasa. So Parishad Maharaj is saying, is asking, padatrayam, the Supreme Personality of Godhead asked for three pada, three steps of land. He is here, of course, referring to Vamanadeva. So he is asking, kasmad dharir ayachata, ayachata means why did he ask? Why did he beg? Kasmad, why? He is Bhuteshwara. He is the Lord of everything that exists. Why does he have to beg anything from anyone? And what to speak of just three steps of land? Won't he get it anywhere else? Right? Even if it is a place like Mumbai, where three steps of land are difficult, and especially Mumbai local train, where you really have to beg for three steps of land, the Supreme Lord is sitting in everyone's heart as Paramatma. And he is in the heart of every commuter in the local train as Paramatma. Right? And he doesn't have to beg. He is everywhere. So why does he have to beg? Parikshit Maharaj is very curious. And he begged this from, asking this three steps of land from a commuter in Mumbai's local train is still understandable. Maybe the Supreme Lord also respects the troubled situation of the commuters of the local train. But he asks this from whom? He is asking this from Bali Maharaj. Balehe padatrayam bhume. Bali Maharaj se kyon pucha ye? Like a poor man. Theek hai, Bali Maharaj se pucha. Somehow Bali Maharaj, he gave the three steps of land. Then why did he have to arrest Bali Maharaj? Right? So in this question, the entire story is being revealed. That is the nature of Srimad Bhagavatam. The inquiry is so sincere, often the inquiry itself reveals a story, lays the foundation of the story. So why did he arrest Bali Maharaj even after getting the three steps of land? And he is saying, I am very anxious. Please satisfy my inquiry. So then Shukadeva Goswami answers Parishad Maharaj's sincere question. The story actually, in one sense, unfolds from long before, when Durvasa Muni had gifted Indra, Brihaspati was offended by Indra. It's a long story. And thereafter, the devatas, because of offense to their guru, they became very weak. And in course of time, the asuras became very strong, the daityas became very strong. And to get back the kingdom of heaven, to get back strength, power, devatas, they approached Lord Vishnu, requesting his intervention. Lord Vishnu arranged for the beautiful pastime of Samudra Manthan. It was arranged by Lord Vishnu, proposed by Lord Vishnu and also arranged by him. He proposed that you have Samudra Manthan, but to have Samudra Manthan, you need to have a stable foundation. Those who do not Samudra Manthan, but Dahi Manthan, know that if your patra is going to move, you can never make Dahi. So you need stability, you need strength, and you need that special potency to extract that makhan. Or in this case, from the Samudra Manthan, the potency to extract nectar. The Lord blessed the devatas and the Danavas in every respect. As Kurmadev, the foundation, he entered into both Daityas and Danavas as strength. In fact, he also gave the intelligence to the Danavas to cooperate with the Daityas for Samudra Manthan. Finally, when the task of distributing the nectar came, the Lord again appeared as Mohini Murti, because the Daityas were, the Devas were not as strong as the Daityas. So as a result, the Lord came to distribute and tricked the Daityas, the Danavas, into having major part of the nectar being distributed to the devatas. The devatas became strong. In fact, it's explained subsequently that Bali Maharaj, who was the leader of the daityas, he died. Not pretended to die, actually died. And Shukracharya, by his special potency, the same Shukracharya who is speaking the verses today, he brought back Bali Maharaj to life. This is acknowledged by Shukdev Goswami. He is saying that when Bali Maharaj lost his opulence and died in the fight, Shukracharya, who was a descendant of Bhrigu Muni, brought him back to life. And because of this, Bali Maharaj developed a lot of gratitude to Shukracharya. He has given me back life. That means a lot. So let's understand this context, the beginning of all this. Bali Maharaj's gratitude indebtedness to Shukracharya. And it's explained that he began serving Shukracharya with great faith. Shishyo Mahatmartha Nivedana. Nivedanena. He gave up everything in service of Shukracharya. And in fact, the Brahmana descendants of Bhrigu Muni, headed by Shukracharya, were very pleased with Bali Maharaj, his sincerity, his submissiveness. And they guided Bali Maharaj into performing a yajna, whose name was Vishwajit Yajna. Vishwajit, pure Vishwa ko jitne ke liye, punha jitne ke liye, to again win back the entire world. And as they were performing the yajna, they got blessings, not only from Shukracharya, but also from Prahlad Maharaj. Now, Prahlad Maharaj was the grandfather of Bali Maharaj. He was present, very much present there in the entire arena, blessing the efforts. In fact, Prahlad Maharaj blessed Bali Maharaj with a garland of flowers which would never perish, imperishable flowers. As a mark of encouragement, as a mark of respect towards the yajna that he was performing. Now, why was this yajna? It was to go back and conquer the heavenly planets. One might wonder, why is it that Bali Maharaj is being supported in this activity by Prahlad Maharaj? We all understand how Prahlad Maharaj, a great devotee of Lord Vishnu, encouraged his father Hiranyakashipu to give up feelings of he is my friend, he is my enemy. I need to demolish this person, I need to befriend this person. Give up all these activities. And why is that same Prahlad Maharaj encouraging Bali Maharaj to perform the Vishwajit Yajna to get back the heavenly kingdom? So Krishna describes in the 16th chapter of Bhagavad Gita that this world is always characterized by two forces. The Daivi Sampada and the Asuri Sampada. They are always there. Their forces will be there. In fact, it is this, the strengthening of the Daivi forces against the Asuri forces that helps the production of nectar from the Samudra. Therefore, we have, whether it's Krishna or whether it's our children, right? Always you tell the stories of, wo Asura jayega, wo Bhuta jayega, Asura jayega. Right? Because that is required. The Asurik Sampada is required to bring out the Daivi Sampada in its full strength and glory. Children are told even now. And it is never a practice to keep telling children only Alice in Wonderland stories. That is not part of our culture. We tell them so that they know there is something called evil. It will come in different forms. Sometimes the evil forces are in a different planet. Sometimes in a different yuga, those same evil forces are in a different island, like Ravana was in a different island. Sometimes they're in a different city, like Kamsa. He was in a different city than where Krishna was located. And sometimes they're in a very much same heart, but the forces are there. And in one sense, Prahlad Maharaj and Bali Maharaj, very refined individual personalities, were still leading, directing this Asuric forces. So it was, of course, part of the Daivi, the design of the Supreme Lord. So Prahlad Maharaj and Bali Maharaj They were in that arena where Shukracharya was guiding the performance of this yajna. And subsequently, the devatas became very strong. They became so strong by pleasing Shukracharya that they all walked into the heavenly planet, the headquarters. And what happened there? As soon as they were so strong, sometimes a person is so strong that you don't have to put up a fight. His aura and looks itself defeat you. So the devatas were completely scared. They were actually, they didn't feel strong enough to put up a fight. And in fact, Brihaspati also advised them that, you know, this is not the time for you, that the daityas, the asuras are very strong. So you all become invisible. That is the only course of action for you right now. Later on, something has to be done to bring you back to strength. So Bali Maharaj, along with all his associates and guided by Shukracharya, took possession of Indra's throne of the heavenly planet. And in fact, the plan was that he becomes Indra. So, of course, you can't become Indra till you have the required qualification. And Bali Maharaj and Shukracharya, his guru, both of them accepted and appreciated this fact. So one of those samskaras or one of those prerequisites for serving as an Indra is performance of 100 Ashwamedha Yajnas. So indeed, Bali Maharaj was guided by Shukracharya into performing those yajnas one after another. Such he was growing in strength. But at the same time, Indra, he was completely shocked, surprised. How did this happen? So he was told by his guru Brihaspati, Shukracharya, the guru of Bali Maharaj, has been pleased by Bali Maharaj, and because of pleasing guru, he's been specially blessed. And we know what you have done. He is telling Indra, not directly, but indirectly, the history of all the, some gurus you offended, some you killed also. So, of course, that leads to weakening. So Indra was very helpless. He went to his mother, Aditi. Oh mother, please show me the way out. In fact, he didn't even express that. He was feeling very morose. Aditi asked him, what happened? He explained the story. Now, Aditi was not necessarily in the heavenly kingdom. We can understand from the story. It was she and also her husband, Kashyapa, they were in different places doing penances. But when Indra expressed his anguish to Aditi, she was very touched. And she came morose to Kashyapa Muni, who had returned after a lot of tapasya. She expressed to Kashyapa Muni that she's very sad. Now Kashyapa Muni inquired, what makes you so sad? Now she had to express that. She said, in fact, Kashyapa Muni indirectly asked Aditi, are your sons all right? Now your sons, because Kashyapa Muni also had sons from Diti, right? And that was the entire lineage, headed by Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaksha. So, are your sons all right? Which meant, are the devatas headed by Indra all right? And she said, that is the problem. They are not all right. In fact, he asked many questions. He said, have you insulted a guest? Actually, it's so interesting. Many of these conversations you read in Bhagavatam, you understand what is culture. Have you insulted some guest? Have you not performed your penances properly? And so on. Have you not performed charity properly? And the last question he asks is, are your sons okay? She says, no. She expresses desire that Indra needs to regain his kingdom. So, this was a tough proposal for Kashyapa, because of course this means one set of sons against another set of sons. But Kashyapa, he gave very good advice to Aditi. He said, take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, worship him. Akama sarva kamoda kamova moksha kama udharadi tivrena bhakti yoga. Even if there are desires, it is always advised, take shelter of the Supreme Lord. In the process of fulfilling the desire will also get purified. One is fulfilling a desire and the other is purifying the desire.
Sometimes a desire gets fulfilled, but in the fulfillment of the desire is a seed of another desire. There's a great king called Maharaj Bratihari who wrote this series of verses where he had gifted some very precious necklace to his queen, and finally he found that necklace being carried by one of the servants in that kingdom, and he was shocked, what happened? So it appears that he gave it to his wife, but his wife had feelings towards someone else who gave it to someone else, and so on, and this way. So he realized that there is a chain reaction of entanglement here. So there's an entanglement. You fulfill a desire, there's another entanglement. Ya chintayami satatam maisa viraktah. People whom I am thinking about, they are so detached from me. So eventually he says, diktam cha mam cha madanam cha imam cha mam cha. Diktam cha tam cha madanam cha imam cha mam cha. Damn this entire series of attachments that have created this entanglement. Then he wrote Vairagya Shatakam. He also compiles some Niti Shatakam, very interesting, very strong guiding principles. And there he talks extensively about how the desires in this world, the real fulfillment is when one is satisfied and not when a desire is fulfilled. There's difference between the two. So therefore, Kashyapa Muni very intelligently guided his wife, said, let's worship Supreme Lord Vishnu. The desire will get, certainly our desires will get fulfilled and also purified. And in particular, he advised her to perform this Payo Vrata worship. Payo, payasa. Payo means milk. So it's a worship with milk. The deities of Lord had to be worshipped. Very disciplined lifestyle. And for 12 day long worship, she did that. The Lord appeared. She expressed her desire to the Lord. The Lord said, I'll certainly reciprocate with your worship. I will appear through the heart of Kashyapa Muni in your womb. So I will directly reciprocate, so directly that he decided to appear in the womb of Mother Aditi. And that is this very auspicious day of Vamana Dwadashi. The beautiful form of Lord Vamandev has been described in the Srimad Bhagavatam, where it's explained that when the Lord appeared, so ordinarily when we appear in this world, there is pain. And in fact, when someone, if the birth is very successful, people clap also, because one doesn't expect things to be so smooth. One expects hardships in the process of appearance. There is pain. A lot of cleaning has to be done after a child is born. But here it's explained, the beautiful form of the Lord, that he appeared as a brahmachari dwarf. It was on the day of Shravana Dwadashi, when the moon came into the lunar mansion, Shravana, at the auspicious moment of Abhijit, the Lord appeared in this universe. Considering the Lord's appearance very auspicious, all the stars and planets, from the sun to the Saturn, were munificently charitable. So much auspiciousness that the planets and the stars also aligned themselves to celebrate. The sun was at the meridian. This Dwadashi is called Vijaya Dwadashi. And being very pleased, there were Apsaras who also wanted to participate in this appearance. They danced, the Gandharvas, they sang, and Devatas, Manus, Pitas, the fire gods offered prayers to the Lord. And then there's a long list of different personalities who came for the celebration. We have hard enough time inviting a few celebrities to one's birthday. But here, without invitation, so many personalities across the universe came for the appearance of the Lord. So Aditi saw the Supreme Lord appearing from her own womb, accepting a transcendental spiritual form. So they exclaimed, Jai, Jai. The Supreme Lord has appeared. The Supreme Lord has appeared. How was he decorated? When he appeared, he had ornaments as well as weapons in his hand. He was Vamana. Vamana means a short form, a dwarf form. But it's explained by Shukadeva Goswami that this is exactly like a theatrical actor. Kritvan kila karmani saharamina keshava. And Krishna and Balaram appeared. Ati martyani bhagavan guda kapata manusha. They appeared in many, in hidden forms. Just like an actor originally has some other identity. But when he acts, everyone is completely mesmerized. So when the Lord appeared as Vamana, they knew him to be only Vamana and nothing else. So as a result, the sages were very pleased. Everyone likes to see a small child. And in Mayapur, the Mayapur Chandrodaya temple, there's on this specific day, there's a very beautiful ceremony where a small boy is dressed up as Vamana and he just attracts everyone's eyes. It's a big celebration there. So real it was. They performed all ceremonies that are befitting the birthday of a child. So first of all, one of the first things they performed was the sacred Theta ceremony. That's quite early for a child who's born from the womb. So the Gayatri mantra was uttered in Vamana's ears by none other than Suryadev himself. Brihaspati offered him the sacred thread and Kashyapa Muni offered him a straw belt. And then Brahmaji offered him a water pot, Kamandalu. The Saptarishi offered him Kusha grass and in his hand you will find Rudraksha beads which were offered to him by Mother Saraswati herself. The Lord in his beautiful form as Vamana emanated Brahman effulgence which completely brought jubilation to the hearts of the sages and the munis. His beauty surpassed every imagined beauty in this world. Immediately a sacrificial fire was set up and after the sacrifice the Lord set out for a very interesting pastime. Now this is very, the Lord is born, appears, has a set ceremony performed, everything done just in time for the purpose for which he advented. This is how quickly the Lord moves on to the task for which he appeared. Paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha duskritam. He's very quick on this. Lord Krishna, he appeared in, he appeared in Vrindavan. He was transported from the eyes, common eyes point of view, he was transported from Mathura, the prison house. But right from his childhood, from the point of sucking milk, he was performing pastimes of Vinashaya Chaturshkritam, delivering demonesses like Putana, and at the same time Paritranaya Sadhunam, bringing great jubilation to the hearts of the devotees by stealing butter, by singing songs, by dancing to the tune of the gopis. So you heard Vamanadev, he quickly set on the task. He heard, this is just a fifth verse, he heard that Bali Maharaj is performing sacrifice. Ashwamedha Yajna. We describe how Bali Maharaj, under the patronage of Shukracharya, was performing Ashwamedha Yajnas because he wanted to respect the position of Indra, who was supposed to have performed 100 Ashwamedha Yajnas. So he also proceeded in time to that sacrificial arena. Now it's very interesting. In this one verse, the entire pastime is being narrated. Jagama tatra khila sara sambhrito bhare nagam sanna mayan pade pade. He went there to deliver Bali Maharaj during his sacrifice to show his full mercy on Bali Maharaj. And what did he do there? Immediately the conclusion is reached. He pushed the earth, the bhar, not actually the earth, but the burden of the earth with every step. So it is explained here that not only, it was not that he had to wait for asking 3 steps of land. Right from the time of his advent, he was actually reducing the burden of the earth. Killing of Kamsa by Krishna was just a final manifestation. But throughout, he was weakening Kamsa's forces. Krishna was always weakening Kamsa's forces. Similarly, Lord Vamandev, right from his appearance, was weakening the Asuric forces. So when the Lord advents, he also shows that one, through his own sadhana, and through efforts, through seva, through sadachar, has to constantly endeavor. It is not that one fine day, one will attain the desired result. One has to progress towards the desired result at every step. So it's explained here. With every step, he pushed down the bhara of the earth. So like this, the sacrifice was being performed in the sacrificial arena called Bhrugu Kachcha. Bhrugu Muni was the ancestor of Shukracharya. So that area is called Bhrugu Kachcha, where Bali Maharaj was performing sacrifices. Now Bali Maharaj saw this beautiful young dwarf Brahmana adventing. He was very attracted. And especially saw all he had, this small Brahmana boy, appeared to be the charm, the center of attraction for all eyes. All he had was an upper garment of deer skin, as you can see in that beautiful form, matted locks of hair, and brilliant effulgence. Very simple appearance. So in no way was the Lord's form intimidating. Sometimes the Lord can take very intimidating forms. But the Lord knows how to subdue every demoniac force. It is not that the same solution for every problem. The principle may be the same, but the manifestation can be so different. Here he was. He was defeating everyone with his brilliance. In fact, all the sages, they stood up from their seats. Bali Maharaj, he stood up and started offering worship to Lord Vamandev by washing his feet. Both Bali Maharaj and his wife Vindhyavali, it is said they were washing the feet of Vamandev. There is a description of all the other personalities who were also in the sacrificial arena. Bali Maharaj then spoke to Vamana, "O Brahmana, I welcome you and offer my respectful obeisances unto you. Please let me know, what can I do for you?" We think that you are the summum bonum of all Brahminical austerities, personified austerity of all the sages. Please let me know, what can I do for you? What can I give you? And he says how Vamana asking for anything from him will be the fulfillment of his sacrifice. Now Lord Vamana, what did he do? First, Lord Vamana actually praised Bali Maharaj's position. He said, "O King, you are indeed exalted. Why are you exalted?" So it's very interesting. Whenever great sages would go to a person, they would explain who that person is and whose ancestry is. That was considered very important. Just like when Vishwamitra Muni took Lord Ram to the Swayamvara ceremony of Sita Devi, there were exchange of the entire genealogy, the background of both sides, both Sita Devi Janaka's side and also the ancestry of Lord Ramchandra. So here he says, "You are exalted because you are surrounded by great personalities. You have great Brahmanas and advisors." And he is specifically referring to Shukracharya. Now Shukracharya in the Srimad Bhagavad Gita 10th chapter, Krishna says, "Kavi naam ushana kavihi." Kavi is those who are thinker. Those who are wise, who are thinkers, they are also referred to as kavi. So all kavis, I am ushana kavi. So in fact, ushana kavi is Shukracharya. Now Shukra, for those who are familiar, there is something called Shukra Niti, which is all about Niti, Vyavahar, how to behave. Now Shukra Niti is considered very, very, very practical and actually quite refined also. And Krishna says, of all kavis, I am Ushna Kavi. That's a big opulence. And here directly Vamana Dev is saying, you are most fortunate, O Bali Maharaj, because you are advised by none other than Shukracharya. But you are also glorious. Why? Because you have the peaceful and venerable Prahlad Maharaj as your grandfather. Being blessed by all this, veritably, the statements that you speak will be filled with truth. You will not speak falsehood just to please others. He is already preparing the background for what is to come by explaining the strength of Bali Maharaj, his own strength and the strength he has inherited from others. So all of these qualities, he says, they keep up with your nature and they enhance the reputation of your entire lineage. And I know nobody in your family has been miserly. Therefore, I know what I have come to ask, I will get. So confident Vaman Dev is. A small drop Brahmana speaking like this. You can imagine how attractive it must be. He said, never in your dynasty has the low-minded king been born. Now one might wonder, why is he not referring to Hiranyakashipu as a low-minded king? Usi dynasty mein to the. But he's saying, he's specifically referring in the context of giving charity. Nobody in your family would deny giving profuse charity. From that point of view, at least. Two things are considered very offensive, a very improper behavior. Somebody asks for charity, you refuse to give charity. A kshatriya asks you to fight and you say, yudh nahi kar sakta. Right? So these are very big insults. Potency nahi hai to reciprocate. So no, nobody in your dynasty would have refused these two things, which are extremely befitting a kshatriya. And now you have physically in your arena Prahlad Maharaj, who's like the moon in the sky. So how can we expect such a behavior from you? Right? It's very interesting. Why is he saying all this? So like this, he goes on. He explains the glory of Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaksha, and so on. And finally, he says, oh, great king, all I want from you, because you have asked me, I'm requesting from you, please give me just 3 steps of land. 3 paces of land to the measurement of my steps. Not little Brahmana is saying this. He's so precise. And somebody can say, kiske jute? Size konsa, right? 3 jute, konse size ke? But he's very specific. And by the measurement of my steps only, O Bali Maharaj, no anxiety for you. He says, although you are very munificent and are able to give me as much as I ask for, asking for what is more than necessary is not desirable. Brahmana, if he starts becoming greedy, and especially if a Brahmana starts hoarding wealth, hoarding means collecting and accumulating wealth, keep ticking his bank account unnecessarily, for a Brahminical person, it is considered the root of all vice. All vice he will start committing. Srila Prabhupada explains this in the lecture. And therefore, when Brahmanas start hoarding too much, that is when we find the downfall of not only the Brahmanas, but the Kshatriyas and others also starts happening. So Bali Maharaj is already hinting to this most profound principle, which later on, of course, we see in the story of many other stories, manifesting how Kali finally advented with the downfall of Brahminical principles. So Bali Maharaj, when he heard this, he was very tickled, you know, tickling. He was, I mean, after all this glorification, you can give whatever you want. Give me 3 steps of land. So whatever you have said, you have spoken like a highly learned scholar. But I think your intelligence is little insufficient. कहीं तो थोड़ी त्रुटि आ गई है, some little shortcoming in what you are speaking. Therefore, you are not really understanding what your self-interest is. You don't know where you have come. You know where you have come by rote. Sometimes we speak, no? We keep speaking, Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. One thing is to speak, the other is to experience and know what that means. Right? Like, sometimes we go to the Lord and ask for such frugal things, when he can offer a lot more. This lady, she had a heavy load, having difficulty to carry. The Supreme Lord asked, what do you want? He said, oh, give me the strength to carry this. Just please just put this tokri on my head. So that's all she could ask. Because it's not just about addressing the Lord as Bhagavan, but experiencing the opulence of the Lord, having that experience of relationship with the Lord. Similarly, he's saying, you don't know, you have no experience of dealing with a king, apparently. I can give you an island. Because I am the proprietor of all the three planets. Teen logo ka main swami hoon. So now you can start seeing what Bali Maharaj is very proud about. He is proud. Therefore, it's a very nice verse by a South Indian Acharya. He says, Pritya daitye tava tanumaha prekshana sarvathapi twamaradya jita rachana anjali sanjagada matta kimte samabhilashitam viprasuno vadatvam vittam bhaktam bhavanamavanavi vapi sarvam pradasye. I will give you whatever you want, vitta, wealth. You want bhavanam, I will give you that. Bali Maharaj is offering everything he wants. This Acharya actually summarizes the entire episode of Vamana Avatar and Bali Maharaj pastime in 10 verses. This is the first verse where he's summarizing the entire episode so far. Vabhi sarve pradasi, jo pradasi, I'll give you, dasi, I'll give you. Whatever you ask me, I'll give you. So, this is interesting. Now, Bali Maharaj is asking all this with folded hands also. Bali Maharaj, please ask me whatever you want. In response, what is Lord Vamana saying? If one cannot be satisfied with three steps of land, one cannot be satisfied with the entire three worlds. Because fulfillment of desire is not as much important as satisfaction. That is the greatest wealth a person can have. Now, why did he say this? Again, this Acharya summarizes. He says that this personality called Bali Maharaj was, though he was claiming to be able to give anything, he was very proud of what he wanted to give, of what he had the capability of offering. So it's explained, Tamikshanam Baligiram Upakarnya Karunyapurno Pyasyo Sekam Shamaitumano Matta Daityavam Sham Prashansan. So Shamaitum. To Shamaitum, to subdue the pride of the Daitya Vamsha. Now it's very interesting. The Lord advented, the Lord asked for these three steps of land, not to subdue just Bali Maharaj's pride, Daitya Vamsha, because he was representing the entire Vamsha of the Daityas. It's very important. What you are and what you represent, both are important. We'll see how Bali Maharaj was, Vamandev was extremely kind and compassionate on Bali Maharaj. But as far as the Daitya Vamsha's pride is concerned, he was uncompromising. That was one of the main purposes, to cripple that pride. So he goes on to say that, oh Bali Maharaj, I'm very happy with what I've asked for. Please just grant what I've asked. Now, simultaneously, as this conversation was going on, Bali Maharaj finally granted, take what you want, whatever you like. But Shukracharya, the third personality in this scene, he interrupted. He said, O son of Virochana, this Brahmachari who has come in the form of a dwarf Brahmana, he is none other than the Supreme Personality of Godhead. We are all mesmerized by his childlike attributes. But what he is capable of doing, is what the Supreme Lord is capable of doing. He has simply accepted Aditi and Kashyapa as his parents, but he has a purpose of his own. So, O Bali, you have accepted a very dangerous position by committing on these three steps of land. This promise is not very good for you. Now, when Shukracharya narrated this to Bali Maharaj. Now one can understand the situation. Shukracharya had saved the life of Bali Maharaj, brought him back to life, not just saved. Bali Maharaj was very grateful to Shukracharya for his guidance. And that's his, by his guidance that he had come so far. And this was acknowledged by none other than Brihaspati to Indra, the grace of Shukracharya. Now how would Bali Maharaj respond to this statements of Shukracharya? Now Shukracharya gives a lot of practical logic as well. As I said, Krishna says, Rishi Naam Ushana Kavi, Kavi Naam Ushana Kavi. So the Shukra Niti has its own place. Krishna in fact refers to Shukra Niti many times in the Mahabharata as well. One of the aspects that Shukracharya said is, yes, you should speak truth, you should stick to truth, but not if it is putting your own life or your near and dear ones at stake. In that case, you may compromise. So he was basically providing some exit routes from what he had committed, Bali Maharaj had committed. And he had said, wealth is not just of one type, there are five types of wealth. One should have wealth. One, the real wealth is what that which takes us beyond this material world, beyond the heavenly planets to our eternal abode. Parastasmatu bhavanyo vyaktyo vipta sanatana. But there are also other kinds of wealth. The wealth that is required to maintain some position in society so that people respect you. Yasha, for maintaining your yasha. He gives reference to that kind of wealth. There is a kind of wealth which is required for the bare sustenance of the body. There is a kind of wealth which is required for little bit more than the bare sustenance of body. For example, to have some festivities, to have some celebrations, which of course are sattvic and promoting more and more virtuous thoughts, but that is also required. Then one also needs wealth for the future generation, one has to invest. It's basically, it's called capital, right? Capital is something that can be used in the future as well, is invested into the future. So he gives this five kinds of wealth. So therefore, you have to preserve it. What if this Vamana takes everything away from you? And I know he has come to take everything away from you. He's telling what will happen. He's providing the trailer of what will happen already. First, he will occupy the three worlds with one step. Then he will take the second step and occupy everything in outer space. Abhi yahan jo dikh raha hai Brahmand, wo pehle, uske baad Brahmand ke bahar, everything else that exists. Where will you offer him the third step? Shukracharya is saying, it's not just that you will lose everything, but you will be unable to even fulfill his promise. Tartha isya kuto gatihi. Tab kahan jayenge aap? Where will the third step go? So, you're saying you'll fulfill your promise, you'll lose everything, you'll still be unable to fulfill your promise. Now look at, it makes sense, right? What is the point of committing on something which I can't fulfill also? Na ghar ka na ghat ka, as they say, right? So he gives lots of such reasons why you can go back. So the safest route is to say no. Say no. Now what did Bali Maharaj do? Very interesting. So he says, Bali Maharaj for some time, he remained silent. Because he contemplated. He did not immediately react. That's a good strategy in general. When one is in a confused state, to do turn left or right, pause, contemplate. And after full deliberation, very interesting, Tushnim Bhutva Kshanam, he thought about it for some time. And then he spoke to his guru as follows. He said, as you have yourself stated. Now Bali Maharaj, he refers to whatever Shukracharya himself said. It's amazing. I mean, the way he responds is also very, very cultured. You have said those principles, those dharmic principles, that does not hinder one's artha, economic development, artha prapti, kama purti, sense gratification, and yashap prapti, attainment of fame, which means people remember you nicely, think about you nicely, is accepted as the real occupational duty. So that should be accepted. And I think whatever you have spoken is correct. So in that sense, He agrees with Shukracharya. But, oh Shukracharya, please try to understand the promise I have given is not just my promise. I represent Prahlad Maharaj. He says, I am the grandson of Prahlad Maharaj. And therefore, how can I go back on my words? He's giving a primary reason. Because now that will mean untruthful. And he says, untruthfulness is such a thing that Mother Earth can't bear. I can bear anything heavy, very heavy equipment I can bear, thoughts heavy I can bear, but I can't bear a person who's a liar. This is Bali Maharaj is giving this reason. Now one might wonder why Lord Krishna told Yudhishthir Maharaj to announce that Ashwatthama was dead on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. Well, he wasn't lying because technically speaking, there's an elephant, Ashwatthama, who died. But at the same time, the real truth is that which is in the interest of everyone. That which benefits everyone is real truth. So, it is in that sense that Bali Maharaj is referring, and he's going to substantiate this point in the verses to come. So he says that all the material opulences of this world cannot give satisfaction. If this dwarf Brahmana is satisfied with whatever I can offer, why not? And he gives references. See, again, this is such a cultured way of presenting. He's not just saying, I will do it. Who are you to speak? He gives references to Shibi Maharaj, who was trying to protect a pigeon from a vulture. And in exchange for that pigeon, he offered flesh from his own body equal to that weight. Dadichi, who offered his bones for the creation of Astra. So there's such great personalities, and Bali Maharaj is not referring only to all these references are from the devatas, from the Daivi Prakriti. These are not Asuric people. So he's referring, which means even Shukracharya would refer to such personalities. So it was common. And then he goes on to say, all these are important points. He gives many external Laukik reasons. Laukik reasons means reasons for behavior in this world. He says, but suppose I accept your point that he's Vishnu who has come to take everything away. Okay, now keep aside the other reasons. Even if he's Vishnu who has come to take everything away, why did he come as a dwarf? If he's Vishnu, he could have come himself to take. But out of fear he has come in the form of a Brahmana. Now if he has come out of fear, then I have to behave with him like a Brahmana. He has come to me begging. He has assumed the form of a Brahmana. So, in this situation, I will not retaliate with him as a Supreme Lord. In fact, I will behave with him as a Brahmana. And then he goes on to give another crystal of reason. He says, if this Brahmana is really Vishnu, sach mein hi Vishnu hai, then what is the loss? Because the ultimate purpose is Varnashramacharvatha Purushena Parampuman Vishnur Aradhyate Panta Nanyat Tattoshakaranam. Ultimate purpose of every dharma, Savai Pumsam Paro Dharmo Yato Bhakti Radokshaje Ahai Tuki Apratihata. That is a Paro Dharmo. So if I have an opportunity to offer everything to Vamana, why shouldn't I offer? So he went ahead, he stuck. Now Shukracharya wasn't very happy because Shukracharya had invested a lot into this entire thing. Imagine bringing back Bali Maharaj to life, ahaan se lekar, guiding him, Vishwajit Yagya, yahaan tak, such a big Yagya that Vamandev himself appeared in the womb for this Yagya. Can you imagine how grand that Yagya was? And therefore, Shukracharya, for him, it was a big investment of energy, of thoughts, the entire movement of that Yagya. So, when Bali Maharaj, he gave these very gentle reasons, but firmly presented these reasons, Shukracharya wasn't very happy. So, as Bali Maharaj and his wife Vindhyavali were offering water, again washing the feet of Vamandev, offering water to him, and to start the process of giving him what he had asked for, Shukracharya, out of anger, he cursed Bali Maharaj that you will lose all your property, you will be bereft of all your riches. because you are not heeding to advice that will help you prosper in this today and tomorrow. So eventually, Bali Maharaj, he didn't respond. Very testing times for Bali Maharaj. I mean, testing times and more testing times to come. What happened next? As predicted by Shukracharya, Srila Vamandev, with his first step, what did he cover? He covered the entire kingdom of Bali Maharaj. It's a beautiful description provided here in the 20th chapter of the 21st chapter of the 8th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. So he saw the unlimited form of the Lord Vamana. He was increasing in size. So he had said three steps that my became big. Right? He became so big that everything in this universe was not filled by his body but became within his body, contained in his body. So like this, the first step, the second step, he covered everything that existed in this universe. There's no space left, exactly as predicted by Shukracharya. And Bali Maharaj, of course, in this opulence, he saw many more things. It's explained that Brahmaji and the celestial beings in the higher planetary systems, they were offering Abhishek to Lord's lotus feet. According to some acharyas, the Abhishek they were offering came in the form of Mother Ganga here. And of course, it's also explained in the Bhagavatam that the Lord's beautiful toenails, they penetrated the covering of this material universe. The water from the divine abode of the Lord entered into this universe in the form of Mother Ganga. So the Mother Ganga appeared as Charanamrit in reciprocation to the Lord's expansion. Bali Maharaj saw a lot more opulences in the unlimited expansion of the Lord. He could see everything from the higher and the lower planetary systems being eternally a part of the Supreme Lord. It was a big realization for Bali Maharaj to see what I was about to offer to the Lord is already His. So in the midst of all this, in the midst of this huge, grandest display of Vamandev, very humbling situation for Bali Maharaj, a scene in which he saw all the oceans in the Lord's waist, the sun and the moon he saw as the eyes of the Lord. The Lord now put Bali Maharaj in an even more tricky situation. The tricky situation was only two steps so far. Third step kahan par? So the Lord summoned Garuda. Do step hue. Teesra he didn't offer. He has not fulfilled his promise. And indeed Shukracharya had said that, predicted that. Arrest Bali for not fulfilling his promise. So Bali Maharaj was actually duly arrested by Garuda. Thereafter, Lord Vamandev asked Bali Maharaj, what will you offer me now? Where is the third step? You have to fulfill your promise. Now it's interesting. Vamandev addresses Bali Maharaj as a cheat. You have cheated me. You have not offered me the three step. I mean, now, who expected Vamandev's three steps to be so big? Bali Maharaj could have said, oh Lord, you have cheated me. I thought three small steps. Now three big steps, you didn't measurement I should have taken before you expanded. But Bali Maharaj, he understood. He was not in a mood of arguing with and defeating the Lord. He understood this as the Lord's arrangement. A special arrangement for crushing his pride. So what did he say? He said, oh Lord, I have nothing else to offer but myself. I offer myself unto you. Atma Nivedanam. Which is the most difficult thing. Often it's easy to give away wealth. It's easy to also offer one's energies, one's body, one's time, but to give oneself, which means align one's body, mind and existence with the Lord. Lord Krishna, he glorifies the trees. Etavad Janma Safalyam, Dehinami Hadeshu, Prana Rarthe Diya Vacha, Shreya Acharanam Sada. Yes, Prana is there, Artha is there, Vacha is there. But one's existence being offered is another dimension altogether. That is the glory of Bali Maharaj. So when Bali Maharaj made all these offerings, we come to the verse we began with today. Or a few verses before that. So a few verses before that, Vaman Dev makes an inquiry. He starts inquiring from the people present there. There were different personalities. Shukracharya was present there. Prahlad Maharaj was present there. In fact, Bali Maharaj, after this entire episode, he is completely awestruck. He is filled with gratitude towards the Supreme Lord. But nevertheless, Lord Vamana asks a question to Shukracharya. He says, Shukracharya, what was the mistake in what Bali Maharaj performed? Was there a mistake? Did he go wrong in disobeying you? Was that the mistake he made? Was it the mistake that he should have measured my steps before he offered? Should he have really inquired in details what the offering was supposed to be like? What was the mistake he made? So the verse we recited today was basically the response of Shukracharya. Shukracharya says, yes, there may be many discrepancies a person may perform. The discrepancies may be in chanting mantras. The discrepancies could be in observing regulative principles. There may be discrepancies in regard to time, place and circumstance. Deshe kale cha patre cha. Krishna also says in the 17th, 18th chapter of Bhagavad Gita especially, how every activity has to be performed according to time, place and situation. The right activity at the wrong place is a discrepancy. So was that a mistake? He says, no. Shukracharya himself says, when your Lord's holy name is chanted, when you are remembered, when offerings are made unto you, everything becomes faultless. So we see from Shukracharya's perspective what he saw. Yes, he was offended when Bali Maharaj didn't listen to him. But being blessed by the association of personalities like Bali Maharaj, seeing the determination of, personalities like Prahlad Maharaj and determination of Bali Maharaj, and most importantly, the presence of Lord Vamandev, Shukracharya realized that Bali Maharaj made no mistake. There was no discrepancy in what he did. He offered everything to you. It's very interesting. The Lord is so personal, even he is driving home this point through Shukracharya, who opposed this entire move by Bali Maharaj. That's the divine transcendental touch of the Lord. That's how powerful his vani is, his vapu is. So from Shukracharya's perspective, in our own lives, we may, as parents, or sometimes advisors, sometimes we are counseling people, we might be like Shukracharya. But one great lesson we can learn is, if we are always surrounded by personalities like Prahlad Maharaj, and if we appreciate the presence of the Lord, we appreciate the devotion in the heart of a devotee towards the Lord, we can have every chance to correct ourselves. From the point of view of Vamanadev, what was his entire pastime? It's very interesting. As far as externally, as far as Bali Maharaj is concerned, Lord Vamandev was absolutely ruthless. He first of all adventured just to take everything away from Bali Maharaj to give to Indra. Can you imagine? So he was absolutely clear. The mission was to be accomplished, and it was accomplished even before it was accomplished. That is Lord, right? So no argument, no opposition. We See, very many such interesting episodes. Bhishma Dev. Now, Bhishma Dev was in a very precarious situation. He was on the side of the Kauravas, fighting there. Just before the battlefield, battle of Kurukshetra, Lord Krishna approaches Bhishma and asks him, do you really want to fight on the side of the Kauravas? And it's a long conversation. And Bhishma Dev, he confesses, very difficult situation, O Lord. So far, I have been going by my prana. But now I realize, what are the options? So they discuss options. One option was for Bhishma to join the Pandavas. If he joins the Pandavas, what would happen? In one sense, the war would not take place at all. Because Duryodhan, he used to speak a lot, but not necessarily act that much. Right? Was he capable of doing anything without Bhishma? No. I mean, the entire army might even just go away with Bhishma. So his capability was very less. So war would have been avoided. But there is an interesting conversation. Krishna says, what about all the demoniac forces that have assembled now? Because the demonic forces have to be crippled. And again, it's not once and done. It happens again and again. The demonic thoughts have to be worked upon. Demonic forces have to be worked upon. So they have all come together. So this was a discussion, and Krishna said, you have to decide, Bhishma. And Bhishma, he said, what else can I do? Other possibilities are retreat. Like Vidura, I go away. But again, that would amount to the war not taking place. So Bhishma, in consultation with Lord Krishna, found that, well, just before the war, this was the best option, fighting on the side of the Kauravas. But he decided, I will do everything I can to ensure that victory is on the side of Dharma. That Bhishma had resolved. And therefore he had resolved, I will not kill any of the Pandavas and so on. So difficult situations can be there. But when Bhishma, he took the vow to annihilate the Pandava army on one of the days of the battlefield, he was fighting so ferociously, Krishna, he became very angry. And he took up the ratha, chariot wheel, and attacked Bhishma, came running towards Bhishma, beautiful form of Lord as Rathangapani. He broke his own vow of not lifting a weapon, because he realized that Bhishma was actually coming in the way of the victory of the Pandavas. So we can see that Bhishma was in a predicament. Krishna reciprocated perfectly with his devotion. But externally, as far as Nyaya was concerned, as far as the laws are concerned, Krishna was actually very, very objective. So we can see that Vamana, Lord Vamana, he was kind upon Bali Maharaj as a person. But as far as the forces, Asuric forces that he was representing, Bali Maharaj, it had to be crippled for the establishment of Dharma. A very interesting story more recently, 500 years ago, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he was in Jagannath Puri. Now, there was a devotee of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu whose name was Bhavanand Rai, who had 5 sons. One of the sons was Gopinath Patnayaka. Now, Gopinath Patnayaka was a tehsildar in a district called Midnapur in West Bengal. And tehsildar, they also do collection of taxes. Now, in the collection of taxes on behalf of the king, Maharaj Pratap Rudra, there was some discrepancy on the part of Gopinath Patnayaka. It's explained that some 200,000 gold coins, there was a shortage. And as a result of this, what happened? He didn't have the money to somehow pay that. He had used some of that money for some other sacrifices and other activities, social activities. To compensate for that, about a dozen horses he offered. And he offered to the king, I'll sell these horses in compensation for that. And what happened was, one of the king sent one of his sons, the eldest son probably, who was called Banajana, basically the heir to the throne, to inspect the horses. Now this prince, heir to the throne, he inspected the horses and commented, in fact, he was underrating the horses terribly, for much less price than what they were worth. And this is what Gopinath Patnayaka felt. So when he commented that these horses are not worth what you're saying, Gopinath Patnayaka, in a somewhat helpless state, he commented that my horses are not like you. he says that they look up, their neck looks up. So what happened is this Bana Jana had this problem. He had this it's called a kind of a quirk. So he would repeatedly stretch his neck and then look from side to side. So sarcastically, Gopinath Patnaika said that my horses lift their mouth, their noses, but at least they don't keep looking in the air like you. So he was saying that my horses are better than you. So how can you rate them so lowly? And this was very offensive for the king's son. And he sentenced Gopinath Patnaika to Changa. Changa is where a big, there's a sword in the bottom and there's a big scaffolding, heavy weight, which makes a person fall heavily on the sword. Basically capital punishment. Now that was a heavy punishment for this. The prince was very angry. The news reached Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that your dear servant is being sent to Changa. In fact, one of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's very close associates, Sarvadutta Damodar Goswami, also appealed to the Lord, please do something. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said that he has misappropriated money, and therefore the king has a reason for sentencing him to death. Why do you want me to interfere in this? When devotees kept on insisting, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he said, if you keep insisting, I will go away to a place called Alarnath, which is a little far away from Puri. I mean, I don't want to be disturbed by all this, these kinds of requests, bothersome requests. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, however, said, please pray to Lord Jagannath. If he desires, something can happen. Now, it's interesting, somehow, by the Lord's grace, one of the ministers of the king, his name was Harishchandra Patra, in his heart, he got an inspiration. He thought, let us do a little bit more inquiry. He brought this to the attention of the king. The king came and made an inquiry. Are, this matter has been escalated unnecessarily so much. From where it has gone where? The king immediately excused. And it's explained that reciprocation for all this turmoil that was created, the king excused, not only excused Gopinath Patnaika, gave him back double the pension with the job and so on. In fact, doubled his pension. So, however, now what was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's reaction? It's interesting. So, since I want to spend a few minutes, what is all this from the perspective of the Lord? What is this Bali Maharaj's beautiful pastime from the perspective of the Lord? Well, of course, the Lord knows. But as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu revealed in a very interesting related pastime, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was informed by one of his devotees that they were all, in fact, it was not just Gopinath Patnaik, all his brothers were also arrested. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu inquired, Eta Prabhu Sei Manushyera Prashna Koila, Maninata Ki Kari Yaba Bandiya Anila. When all of them were bandis, and they were all being in the prison house, what did they do? The messenger replied, Se kahe vaninata nirbhaya laya Krishna naam, Hare Krishna kahe avishram. He said, when they were in that difficult situation, they chanted the holy names of Lord Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. And in fact, he was not just chanting, he was counting while chanting. Now, that's amazing. You're being sentenced to death and you're counting while chanting. And after chanting 1,000 times, he would make a mark on his body so that he knows 1,000 is over, another 1,000, another 1,000. And the Lord heard this, he was very pleased. And then the Lord was informed that, finally the Lord was informed that Gopinath Patnaika and others were released. So the Lord had an audience with Gopinath Patnaika later. So he said, he asked Gopinath Patnaika, what happened? So Gopinath Patnaika said, I was lifted to the Changa to be killed, but instead I was honored with the silken cloth. It is all your mercy. What was I doing on the Changa, O Lord? I was meditating on your lotus feet. And that power of your remembrance has yielded all these results. Now one might wonder, being released, being adorned with silken cloth, double pension, is this the real mercy of the Lord? Yes. Now Gopinath Patnaik is saying this is how the law, how the common population perceives, and therefore I am saying this is your mercy because people are perceiving this as your mercy. So struck by wonder with this your affairs, the people are glorifying the greatness of your mercy. But Gopinath Patnaik says, how are you, Lord? That's not your real mercy. Just like Gopinath Patnaik was blessed by all this in the pastime of Vamanadev, Bali Maharaj was also blessed by the Lord. What did he bless Bali Maharaj with? He gave him in the Sutala Loka a place which is even more opulent than that of Indra. For all the punishment that Bali Maharaj got, he was glorified and he was placed in that beautiful abode in Sutala Loka. Not only that, Vamandev said, I will myself stand there as Dwarpal. I will be the doorkeeper, gatekeeper to your abode. And Prahlad Maharaj, you will also be there constantly glorifying me. So we can see, yes, devotional service to the Lord can yield you results which from an external point of view appear like blessings. And they are indeed blessings. No devotee will not count them as blessings. And Gopinath Patnaik did. However, he said, there is a higher blessing. He said, these are not the principal results of meditating on your lotus feet. Kintu tomara smaranera nahiyai mukhya phala phala bhashayai yate vishaya chanchala. These are all vishaya chanchala. What is the real benefit? The real benefit is that one gets granted loving devotion service to you. So he is not belittling any of the other blessings of the Lord. But he is saying the fructification of all that is when the seed matures into this creeper which grows and touches your lotus feet. It's not one versus the other, but what is the real fructification? So he said, please bestow that mercy upon me so that I may develop renunciation and constantly remember your holy names, your pastimes, and develop intense attraction to your lotus feet. So Vamandev himself glorifies Bali Maharaj and says, you are very blessed. On one hand, you have the guidance of personalities like Shukracharya, who guide you in the practical affairs of this world. And it was Shukracharya's admission that we started with. What did Shukracharya say? Oh Lord, there may be all kinds of deficiencies and activities, but the chanting of your holy name brings auspiciousness everywhere, in all circumstances. So being blessed with Bali Maharaj, you are blessed with Shukracharya, who can give you practical guidance, but you are also blessed with Prahlad Maharaj, by whose association even Shukracharya is able to appreciate the chanting of the Lord's holy names. So it's a very beautiful pastime where we see from the Lord's perspective, he always wants to establish dharma. But even in asuric forces, wherever he sees pure devotion, he glorifies it. And establishes that devotion even in seemingly difficult situations, just like a diamond studded on a gold ring. Yes, the situation may be nice, it may not be so nice, but the diamond will always shine. The diamond on a gold ring and the diamond on an iron ring will be equally shining. Though it might be desirable to also have the gold ring to further enhance the shining of the diamond. So we see that Bali Maharaj's cultural upbringing from Prahlad Maharaj, he took that, grabbed that opportunity to attain the fulfillment of all forms of worship of Krishna, which is that complete surrender. But at the same time, Bali Maharaj went back to Sutala Loka under the guidance of Prahlad Maharaj. Shukracharya remained his guru. It's not that Shukracharya, he had a new guru after that. And with the personal audience of Lord Vamandev, Bali Maharaj kept continuing his activities as a personal sadhaka under the guidance of Prahlad Maharaj, at the same time performing whatever he could representing the forces of the daityas. That by Lord's arrangement, he was destined to lead. On this beautiful day of appearance of Lord Vamandev, also the appearance of Shri Jiva Goswami, we can offer our heartfelt prayers of appreciation to Lord Vamandev's transcendental pastimes, prayers of gratitude to Bali Maharaj and Prahlad Maharaj for setting such lofty standards, such high pure ideals. And we can also pray at the lotus feet of Shri Jiva Goswami, who through such enlightening purports as we read today, established the summum bonum of all forms of ritualistic activities, which is to attain transcendental, spontaneous, loving, devotional service to Lord Krishna, especially by chanting his holy names. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. If there is a question, probably we can take one.
I have a like small question. In most of the books of Srila Prabhupada to the Western audience, they have written the word as Supreme Personality of Godhead for Bhagavan and for demigods, which is Devata in Indian perspective. Why these two words are used, demigods for Devata, which is from, because in Greek word also Deus, divine, and Devata, and for Bhagavan, it is Supreme Personality of Godhead and Supreme God. So all these words are English parlance, we can say. These are English words. But and because most of the Indian they say they say that why do you use all these words for our gods, like Supreme Person of Godhead, Supreme God, we should use Bhagawan or Devata. So
how would you translate pizza into Hindi? You don't have equivalent of pizza, so people say roti, all kind of forms of roti, right? So if there's no equivalent word, Prabhupada, based on his sincere desire, transcendental empowerment from acharyas, he did the best he could to convey this message in English. So if there's no equivalent, you find the closest. If there's a question related to the class today, yeah.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Present Indra King Purandar, who has got the heavenly kingdom simply by the mercy of Lord Vamandev. And the demigods are strict followers of Vedic injunctions. They also obey the authorities of Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, and Lord Vishnu. Now it is stated that when the time will come for this particular Purandar, the present king of Indra, present king of heaven as Indra, when his term will come to an end, Lord Vamandev will ask him to retire and coronate Bali Maharaj is the next Indra. But this particular Indra will refuse, and Lord Vamandev will have to fight with him to take away the kingdom and then coronate Bali Maharaj. So how is it like is it a kind of a default setting in the consciousness of heavenly demigods that once they are there, they don't want to leave that place, something like never say die? Is it like that?
So general tendency in this material world is to be complacent where we are. So there is a difference between being comfortable and having a comfort level. So Krishna says throughout Bhagavad Gita that one should have a lifestyle which gives you some comfort level. And therefore sattvic lifestyle is encouraged. Therefore Krishna says yukta ahara viharasya. But when things become too comfortable, then the tendency is to be complacent. And therefore this planet where we are is considered very blessed, which we are all encouraged to take full advantage of. On the other hand, the examples you gave of Indra, a heavenly planet, sometimes becoming too possessive, it's also something that comes with power. I mean, even in this world we see when there is power, there is a tendency to get addicted. And therefore, the Lord makes arrangement either through his external energy or through his internal energy to unsettle people who become too complacent. So it's a continuous arrangement, unsettling someone who becomes too complacent. To the extent that the Lord had to unsettle his own Yadu dynasty because he feared complacency. And so that is a reality. It may be unpleasant, but as per the Lord's design, it is required. Because that kind of stirring is what leads to the production of nectar from the ocean through the process of churning, manthan. Hare Krishna. So I think we are out of time. So we'll conclude here. Srila Prabhupada ki. Srila Vamandev ki. Srila Jeev Goswami ki.